Hello and welcome back to Cinematic Universe, everyone. My name is Ernesto Martinez. Joining me, as always, is Damon Hawk. How are you, man?
I'm good.
All right, it's a new week and it's a new episode of Supergirl. And yes, they did name it for the girl who has everything, so they got it right there.
Yep.
Damon, man, you know, I always talk about how much I love DC and stuff like that, but you seem to have a bit more knowledge on the comic side, whereas me, I grew up more with the TV shows and the movies and only recently just got into the comics just for necessity. So this episode, while it's called For the Girl Who Has Everything, it's adapted from the original Superman annual comic For the Man Who Has Everything. So give us a little walkthrough.
Well, first of all, it's an Alan Moore story, an Alan Moore Superman story, and there aren't a ton of those around. But it's largely considered one of the best Superman stories ever. And, I mean, that's not hyperbole. It's absolutely fantastic. And, I mean, it basically deals with a parasitic creature that latches onto Superman and gives him the perfect life in his mind while it leeches his life energy from him. And he sees, you know, Krypton never blew up, and he's very happy, and he's married, and he has a child. And like you said, the animated series did their own version of that, and it was remarkably faithful to the comic. When I first saw that was going to be the second episode, I was waiting excitedly to see it. I think I might have been in Biloxi, Mississippi when that came on, and I watched it and just was overjoyed at how well they did it, how much they got it right. So that's the backstory of For the Man Who Has Everything, and For the Girl Who Has Everything, they go about it in a very similar way with Supergirl. And it's very well done, very well done. They're hitting a lot more than they miss on these episodes lately. I had a blast with it. I thought it was great. What about you, man?
Well, maybe it was just me, but I kind of put this episode at an unfair standard. Because, you know, that story, when it was adapted to animated form, the first time I saw it, I was in Puerto Rico. This was before I moved to Arizona. And while not reading the comics and the original source material, I have already, by that point, grown up with the character of Superman, much like Batman and Wonder Woman. I seen all the Richard Donner movies. I saw the Batman the animated series. I saw his movies, all the way to the Justice League. And, you know, you already know who this character of Superman is. You know, the big Boy Scout in blue. And then you have this episode where it's his birthday. You have Wonder Woman and Batman coming in there like, what do you give a man who has everything? And sure enough, when they get there, he is constricted by what they call the Black Mercy, as you explained it, which pretty much grants the individual his deepest, greatest desires, stuff that he's always wanted, or she. And it pretty much plays off the same way here with Kara. You know, she's back on Krypton and never blew up. Her mom is there. We see a young Kal-El. We see her father. We see her aunt. We see pretty much, you know, what would have happened if Kara had never left the planet. Here's the thing. Every time I see For the Man Who Has Everything, it brings me to tears because of how powerful everything is. You see Superman waking up on a farm, no less. It seems like farming was always going to be part of his, you know, comings growing up. And he's not only married to the love of his life, but he's married to pretty much a woman who looks a lot like Lana Lang and sounds like Lois Lane. And it feels like, man, he has everything he's ever wanted. He's got two of the women he's always loved wrapped into one. He has a child. They have a house. His father's still alive, his mother's still alive, everything he's ever wanted is right there. And slowly but surely it starts crumbling until he comes to the realization that it was never real and he has to say goodbye. Holy shit, and this is a children's cartoon. But, so, when you get the live-action version with Supergirl, it felt a little underwhelming because they did it a little differently. You know, Kara wakes up, but instead of already accepting where she is and she's living her life as if she's never left, she starts questioning it until she starts acclimating and turning into, okay, this is a dream sequence. The Black Mercy is trying to take her whole completely. And I don't know, the emotional connection wasn't there personally because we're only in the first season and we don't have that many episodes. So that emotional tension of her being ripped apart from her dream sequence didn't really hit it home the way the animated version did. And I'll say this pretty much. The episode where she fights Red Tornado and she lets out all her anger and all that rage that she's been holding in to destroy him, I felt more power there than I did here.
Well, that was very powerful. And I see what you're saying. I mean, I get that. I think one of the things that resonated with me the most was the bond that she had formed with Alex, her Earth sister, being strong enough to kind of snap her out of it. And I liked the fact that rather than having already been acclimated to it when everything starts, she's confused. And really, I mean, that works on a number of levels, not the least of which is the audience kind of goes along with her. I mean, especially folks who don't know the story, don't really have that expectation. They're able to kind of feel it with her. But whereas she becomes kind of accepting towards it, they start to realize that, oh, hey, this isn't such a good thing. And so anyway, there's that whole, girl, you better not kind of thing going on.
Yeah. Yeah, and I see what you're saying. I mean, the difference here being that I took it as an approach of, is it going to live up to the previous adaptation rather than, okay, let's see what they do with it. And that's partly my fault, but at the same time, you know, the reason why, if anybody ever asks me, okay, I need to have a good cry, what do you guys recommend I should do? I pretty much tell them, go watch this episode and you're going to cry after you watch it. Like, at some point you could have expected her to wake up and next to her is a combination of Jimmy Olsen and Winn. So
that would have been creepy as hell.
It would have been creepy as hell, but considering that they're the two men in her lives that she loves a lot, I wouldn't have been surprised if there was a combination of sorts.
Yeah, and they probably made the conscious decision not to go there because that would have been telling.
Yeah, exactly.
But one of the things I really, really liked about the episode was the inclusion of James and Winn into the DEO, bringing them in. I thought that added a lot of heart. I really liked the dynamic of all of them working together. Hank turning Winn loose on the computers to try to figure out what was going on. It was a good team dynamic. And I mean, these guys obviously, the Berlanti and company, obviously have a pretty good handle on the team dynamic. They're turning it out really, really strongly in all their other shows. But I liked that aspect of it. I thought it was really strong.
Yeah. Well, now that we got the whole Black Mercy scenario out of the way, let's talk about some things that, you know, other things that happened. Because while, yes, the girl who has everything was the main focus, there were a lot of underlying subplots in the background.
That's some fairly big shit.
Yeah, some fairly big shit. You know when I said that I had a theory that at some point in the show there's going to be like a white Martian invasion and the Kryptonians are going to team up and have a truce? yeah, that's not going to happen anymore. Throw that out of the window. Because freaking Alex jammed a kryptonite sword through Supergirl's hand.
Yeah, I honestly didn't see that coming.
A kryptonite sword.
Yeah.
What the fuck?
Yeah, I like a kryptonite sword, man. You know, why hasn't Batman thought of that?
I know, but it's like, where the fuck did a kryptonite sword come out of? I'm like, why didn't you lead off with that? You had that in your armory all this time? I'm not saying it's a negative. I'm just like, a kryptonite sword. You've had this already. Okay.
Yeah.
But yeah, I wasn't expecting that character to be killed off so early.
Yeah, that's the thing. I don't know that I really agree with that, that choice, because she's pretty much the most charismatic part of the Kryptonians that we've seen. I thought it would be interesting seeing a non that wasn't
an idiot.
A brute, you know? And this guy, I mean, he can speak well, and I mean, he's obviously got some smarts, but he's got no charisma whatsoever.
Yeah.
No charisma whatsoever. Whenever he comes on the screen, that's when I start flipping through my phone. He takes me right out of it.
Yeah, and, you know, that whole confrontation between him and Kara, I'm just like, so is he just going to stand there and take all this abuse? Am I supposed to expect him to say, you can punch me all you want, but I've already won? I mean, what was his game plan? Because he wasn't even lifting a finger. He was just taking it.
Yeah, I don't know.
I mean, I guess by comparison, the whole situation between Kara and her dream sequence was the better part of this episode, and the rest, not so much. I mean, just by comparison, not like the episode as a whole is good, but if I had to pick and choose, I'd rather stay with the girl who has everything rather than not being so charming.
Right.
Yeah.
That's fair. Although, I gotta throw Jimmy and Winn going to the DEO because I thought that was great.
Yeah, I like how Winn was explaining to them the situation and he had to stop at one point. You know, I can pretty much upgrade this for you, right? And they're like, focus on the mission.
Yeah, yeah, good stuff. We got some decent Cat Grant moments here, and I really enjoyed Hank posing as Supergirl, or posing as Kara, with Cat Grant. There were some very choice back and forths between them. Yeah.
I run the DEO. I think I can handle Cat Grant for a day. Doesn't seem like you can.
Yeah, that was. I think he bit off a little more than he could chew. Although, you know, the whole crying thing.
Yeah.
pretty great.
Yeah, it's like, okay, I'm going to just go along with the fact that they're not going to have Jean just read her mind and then do everything that Supergirl should do. So I think they're going to go with the cliche route where it's like, oh, I've done this and that. I think I can handle one lonely human. And then they go with the punchline, no, I can't. This woman makes me wish to be back in my prison cell. So, yeah, that's part of the thing.
Yeah. We get to see John Jones again.
Yeah, we get to see not just John Jones as Hank, but John Jones as in Martian form, kicking ass.
Well, that's what I'm talking about.
Oh, okay.
I mean,
well,
Hank,
then, yes.
He's Hank when he's John, he's John. I'll take, I mean, you know, 5 seconds of that every episode, I'd be a happy camper.
Yep. Well, that's pretty much it, right?
Yeah, pretty much. Although, we did see Supergirl in another media this week. Did you watch The Flash last night?
Oh, yes, I did. That little cameo. Oh, yes, it's happening, everybody. The crossover.
It's not just happening on CBS. I mean, you know, whether or not she shows up in an episode full blown, that was Melissa Benoist as Supergirl flying through the timeline.
Yep.
And that was pretty damn cool. I squeed all over the place. I was like, oh!
you know how we're always saying, you know, back and forth, we can both agree that at this point we'll take what we can get, right?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Holy shit, we're getting a crisis pretty soon.
Yeah, I'm interested to see what they'll do with it. I'm hoping that it works like the first Arrow Flash crossover where they were talking about, we don't know how often we'll do this. It'll probably just be like a once a year kind of thing. And then it just ended up being so insanely good and so popular that they decided, okay, we're not only going to do this every year, but they'll bleed over into each other's shows and stuff like that. I'm hoping that the Supergirl thing works well and is so much fun that they continue to do it on a regular basis.
Yeah.
I don't know how easy that would be or how feasible story-wise, but I'd like to see that.
Yeah. Well, the last thing I'll bring up is that I was skimming through the episodes and our White Martian review, we had a comment, and the person was saying maybe it was the show's intention, maybe I just noticed it, but it kind of felt like they were trying to compare the White Martians and the Green Martians to the whole Nazi regime and the concentration camps. What do you have to say to that?
I think that's probably fairly accurate. I mean, yeah, why not?
All right.
Sounds good to me, very astute.
Yep. You heard it here, folks. As always, my name is Ernesto Martinez. You can find me on Twitter at MartinezXYZ, Cinematic Universe. You can find me on YouTube, if you're already listening, at Cinematic Universe Ultimate. And you can find me on MoviePilot.com, Cinematic Universe, Heir to the Celluloid. As always, my name is Ernesto Martinez. Damon Hawk, thank you for joining me, and see you guys next week.
Bye, guys.
Bye.